Good evening and welcome to this evening's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place you are always in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Gloria Duffy, President and CEO of the club, and your moderator for this evening's program. It's my pleasure to introduce today's special guest, Joseph Cirincione, President of Ploughshares Fund, a global security foundation founded here in San Francisco and also based today in Washington, D.C. Mr. Cirincione served previously as Vice President for National Security and International Policy at the Center for American Progress and as Director for Nonproliferation at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. He also spent 9 years as a professional staff member at the U.S. House Armed Services Committee and the Committee on Government Operations. Mr. Cirincione is the author of Bomb Scare, The History and Future of Nuclear Weapons, as well as numerous other books and articles. He is a frequent blogger and tweeter, a columnist for the Huffington Post, and a frequent commentator on news media programs ranging from ABC News to Al Jazeera. He is one of the best informed, most strategic, most independent, and most influential policy experts on national security issues today. This evening with Joe, we will cover topics related to weapons of mass destruction, conflict situations around the world, the U.S. defense budget, and many other topics really responding to your questions on those and any other subjects you would like Joe to discuss. Joe, welcome to the Commonwealth Club.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
It is a pleasure to have you. So I thought we'd start the discussion by asking you, what's top of mind for you as you think about threats to American security, issues that you're concerned about and dealing with? What are you thinking about, writing about, and worrying about today?
Pakistan. I think Pakistan is the most dangerous country on earth. We've seen a raft of disclosures just in the last couple of weeks on the role of the intelligence service in Pakistan in various attacks on U.S. forces, including on the embassy in Kabul. Pakistan has enough material for about 100 nuclear weapons. It has an unstable government. It has radical Islamic fundamentalist forces that are influential in its military and intelligence services. It shares a border with another nuclear-armed country, India, with which it's waged three wars in the last 50 years. And it has some of the major terrorist networks in the world located in its borders. This is a country that is teetering on nuclear catastrophe. It does not get anywhere near the ink or the airwave attention of Iran or even North Korea for that matter. But for my money, Pakistan is where we might see a major non-NATO ally turn into our worst nuclear nightmare just about overnight. And it's one reason why I think we need a fundamentally new global national security strategy.
Before we talk about a new global national security strategy, say a little more about what you fear in Pakistan. What's the worst case? How could the situation there unravel, and what would the end result be?
There are two worst cases competing for which one comes first. And one is that a terrorist group gets their hands on nuclear material or even a nuclear weapon. Now, nuclear weapons and material are very closely guarded in Pakistan. The Pakistani authorities tell us there's nothing to worry about, and I believe that's true. But it's not a question of the stability of the security around the nuclear weapons. It's a question of the stability of the government. What happens if that government splinters? What happens if the elite troops guarding it, the material, are distracted by urban insurgencies, for example? Who gets control of the weapons? Who gets control of the material to make the weapons? Who gets control of the scientists who know how to manufacture the weapons? That's nightmare scenario number one. Nightmare scenario on number two is that some of the radical elements within Pakistan succeed in their goal, which is to start a war with India. Remember the Mumbai attacks of just a couple of years ago that were done by what we thought was an independent group, we now know was closely connected to the Pakistan intelligence services. Their goal in staging that attack was to provoke a war with India. You know, they are not yet done with that kind of strategy. A war with India, in my view, would quickly escalate from a conventional battle to a nuclear exchange with potentially global consequences. And the two scenarios interact. Some analysts fear that the radicals might intentionally provoke a conflict with Pakistan, with India, in order to mobilize the forces around the nuclear weapons, in order to get them in transit and therefore make them easier for them to get their hands on once they move out of garrison. So those are the two nightmare scenarios that I worry about.
How do you know that these are the objectives of the radicals? I mean, a strategy of having the nuclear weapons dispersed in order to possibly get their hands on them, how do you know that?
That's speculation. That is, it's nowhere on the radical blogs, whereas provoking a war with India is something that you can read about on some of the radical, the websites hosted by radical elements in Pakistan.
So who can do something about that situation? We often start out by saying the U.S. should do X, Y, or Z.
Right.
I mean, who really has influence over that situation?
Well, the situation in Pakistan is so bad that there are several heavy lifts that you have to do just to get in a position where you might be able to do something about it. But it's understanding the threat from Pakistan, what we've just talked about, that helps you understand where there's no sort of traditional national security answer to it. There's no U.S. military intervention that's going to fix that. There's no SWAT team that can go in and seize control of the nuclear weapons. There's no military aid package that's going to fix this, that's going to stabilize Pakistan. I mean, you really have to do years of work in order to stabilize the government, reduce the conflict within India and Pakistan, reduce the conflict in Afghanistan, convince India and Pakistan to walk back from their nuclear programs, convince them to reduce and eventually eliminate their nuclear weapons, which can only happen in a world where the countries with the most nuclear weapons, the U.S. and Russia, are doing the same thing. You get my point. You've got to have a very different national security perspective, a very different idea of how you safeguard U.S. interests in the world than the one we currently have in order to fix that Pakistan nuclear threat.
So we'll get back to specific situations again, but what is this new approach? Is this a radical decrease in nuclear weapons held in the arsenals of major powers, set a good example? Is this sanctions? Is this overt pressure on the countries?
I think you have to start more broadly, and you can start by going back in history about 6 weeks. Let's go back to something we've already forgotten about, which is the overthrow of the Gaddafi regime by the rebel forces in Libya, aided by NATO and the United States. This happened at the end of August. Fareed Zakaria called it a turning point in U.S. Foreign policy. David Rothkopf called it a pivot point in U.S. national security strategy, and I think they're right about that. Now, I know the entire Libyan intervention, it was controversial. I would guess if we took a vote, half the people listening to this program or in this room would have been against the Libyan intervention. But you have to understand what happened here. But in a very short amount of time, rebel forces overthrew one of the longest standing dictators in the world, not to mention in the Arab world. There was significant loss of Libyan life in that, but there was no direct intervention by U.S. military forces in the way those military forces had been used in just the previous decade in Afghanistan and in Iraq, and where some were calling for us to do in Libya, some for calling for us to do in Iran. It was a very different strategy that was employed, and I think that strategy has several basic components which we're now seeing develop into a new national security strategy, although not quite articulated yet. It's happening before us, and I would say that's based on, one, shared interests and shared responsibilities. So NATO intervened in this in cooperation with the Libyan people themselves. And the U.S. took a lead role, but only a role, didn't do it all by themselves. This was not a unilateral military intervention. it was a shared responsibility. Number two, I think you saw a multi-dimensional application of statecraft. It was regional, it was alliance-wide, and most importantly, it was using the United Nations. It was the United Nations' approval of this with the Arab League support that allowed this kind of intervention to go on. It wasn't a U.S. unilateral decision. It was something that was negotiated out. It's underscored the importance in today's world of these multilateral institutions. Third, you saw a very limited use of nuclear force. I understand that there was heavy bombardment. I understand that there was... of military force.
Very limited use.
Limited use of military force.
Sure.
Nothing like what you saw in Iraq mm-hmm. or what some people were advocating. And it was clearly something that the United States and NATO and the rebel forces themselves wanted to do, keep to a minimum level. I got ahead of myself. The fourth point is that you saw a greatly reduced role of nuclear weapons. And I mean that in two senses. This is a struggle, a fight, a war that took place without any consideration of global thermonuclear war, of global strategic balance, the kind of consideration that used to dominate national security strategy for 60 years. There was no play. Those weapons had no role whatsoever in the considerations, in the strategic analysis of this conflict. And second, there was no consideration of using nuclear weapons in the Libyan conflict. And think back, just a few years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, there was active consideration in the United States of developing new nuclear weapons to go after precisely the kinds of targets that presented themselves in Libya, deep underground hardened bunkers. Nobody talked about using nuclear weapons.
Bunker buster.
The so-called bunker bunkers. Mm-hmm. Nobody talked about that. Nuclear weapons are completely irrelevant to the kinds of security threats we now face, as illustrated by the Libyan example.
So the Libyan situation, are you saying that you see a trend towards addressing conflicts that may affect our interests elsewhere in the world, not the way we did unilaterally in Afghanistan and Iraq, but in this new way?
I do.
UN, NATO, collaboration.
And this is part of what people mean by a turning point, a pivot point. This was a success. The Libya intervention was a huge success, and it's sort of like, you know, passed off sometimes. Oh, ho-hum, another success here. We've overthrown another dictator. But it's taking place at this time, I think, because of several intersecting trends. And one is a complete rejection of the national security strategy that preceded it, what you just described, a kind of unilateralist strategy that saw military force as the main instrument of statecraft, that thought we could spread democracy around the world on the points of our Marines' bayonets. That policy has been tried and failed. It's been rejected. The second trend that we see going on, but regionally, globally, and with U.S. national security strategy, is that we're pulling the troops out of Iraq and Afghanistan. Not as fast as some people would like, but it is happening. It is going on. The debate this year is whether we're going to leave 3,000 troops in Iraq at the end of the year or zero. Just last year, we were talking about leaving 30,000 or 17,000. There's no appetite in the American political system now for maintaining those troops. They're pulling out. We're pulling out the troops from Afghanistan as well. So this is part of the new reality we have to deal with. The third trend I see is, of course, the Arab transformation. I mean, everything we just talked about wouldn't be happening without the desire of the people of North Africa and the Arab world to get a new kind of government, not a radical Islamic government, not an Al-Qaeda government, not an Iran-style government, but a kind of basic, open, democratic system that these people deserve and have longed for. And the final trend I think we see is the decline in U.S. military resources. We are now entering a defense build-down, where the U.S. defense budget is going down, not up. After 10 years where that defense budget has doubled, it's now in a point of decline. So you're going to see choices being made in the U.S. Congress, in the administration, for how to husband those resources. Don't get me wrong, we still have an enormous defense budget. It's about $700 billion this year for the base budget, plus the funding for the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, but it is coming down, it is tightening up. That's forcing choices, that's forcing consideration of a new national security strategy.
Let me remind you, your questions are welcome. So either go to the mic or ask for the mic to be brought to you. And so you do need to go to the mic, though, because we're recording this. So if you don't speak in the mic, no recording.
But what about Iran? You didn't mention Iran. What are your perspectives about Iran, and where do you think we're headed?
Big subject. Let me start. Iran is the Islamic regime in Iran is in decline. They are deeply troubled. You think our politics are tough? Go to Tehran. Go to Tehran. There are deep fractures in the regime. Ahmadinejad, who some people just a few years ago were comparing to Hitler, is in a fierce fight with the leader of the Islamic Republic, Ayatollah Khamenei. He has trouble keeping his cabinet officers out of jail currently. I think Iran, because in part of the trends I just described, including the Arab transformations, is more isolated than ever. The Arab people are making their revolutions without Iran. The U.S. strategy towards Iran, though flawed and incomplete and lacking, I think, in some of the multidimensional statecraft that it could be using, has nonetheless succeeded in slowing down Iran's nuclear program, making it very difficult for Iran to advance as rapidly as they wanted, and as a result in severe strains inside the Iranian economy. Iran, I believe, does pose a serious threat to the region and to the U.S., but nowhere near the kind of threat it's sometimes made out to be. I don't believe an Iranian nuclear weapon is either imminent or inevitable. I don't believe we need or should use military force as a threat against that weapon. In fact, I believe that any military attack on Iran in response to or in an effort to stop a nuclear weapon would be counterproductive. It would not stop that weapon. It would probably accelerate the development of that weapon and lead to perhaps a third or fourth war, depending on how you're counting, U.S. war in the Middle East with untold consequences for the U.S. economy.
Let me just follow up that question. What is the U.S. doing in diplomacy or dealing with Iran at this point? This is a subject that is pretty much out of the news. And so I'm just curious, what do you hear, what do you know that we're doing?
Well, first let me tell you why it's out of the news. And one of the reasons it's out of the news is that the effort to sort of start a war with Iran, which was being promoted by many of the same people who convinced us to start a war with Iraq, has largely failed, in large part because the Israeli government has concluded that the Iranian nuclear threat is not as close as some people, including for some Israeli officials, had previously claimed. So there's a sense of somewhat relaxation about the threat, not ignoring it, but we have time to deal with it. And it's coupled by the fact that the U.S. strategy of isolation and multilateral diplomacy and sanctions and sabotage, the Stuxnet virus that crippled over 1,000 Iranian centrifuges out of the 8,000 they had operating, has succeeded, has slowed the program, and has limited Iran's nuclear capabilities. So because of that,
the timeline you see,
the timeline
Iran
is stretched
now
out.
Is
so there's not a panic about Iran. So that's why it's not, you know, the nuclear clock is still ticking in Iran, but it's slowed down. So you don't see that kind of panic, are we going to go to war with Iran, driver that often generates news stories. Second, there's actually been some very interesting developments from inside Iran. In the past month, Iranian officials have made a number of offers to the Europeans and to the United States on the nuclear issue, on the general diplomatic front, offering to start negotiations again, offering various deals that could be made, trading some of their low-enriched uranium in exchange for fuel for their research reactor, So far, the U.S. has been very skeptical of these offers. I think the U.S. is, the Obama administration is not seeing the kinds of strains that the Iranian regime is actually under, not recognizing that there might be something here. I think it's time for the Obama administration to listen to the advice of its military leaders. And specifically, Admiral Mullins, who just retired as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, said that what we need to do is open up channels with Iran. We need to be talking with Iran. Even during the coldest days of the Cold War, we had hotlines to the Soviet Union. We had regular exchanges with the Soviet Union. In case of a crisis, we knew who to talk to. We knew how to defuse a crisis. We don't have anything like that with Iran. And right now, the greatest danger is not that either the U.S. will attack Iran, or Israel will attack Iran, or Iran will attack us. It's that some tensions in the Persian Gulf could lead to a clash of naval forces that could escalate into a military exchange. We need to have military-to-military discussions in order to defuse an accidental war.
Is there a group in Iran with whom the U.S. can talk?
As Admiral Mullins was asked this question, he said anyone, any channel. Any channel that we can open up would be good. So there is, and we have talked with Iran in the past. We cooperated very closely with Iran and had weekly conversations with them during the initial stages of the effort to overthrow the Taliban in Afghanistan. In fact, many people believe that the Taliban was overthrown in Afghanistan only because of Iranian cooperation. We used to have that kind of discussion. We can do it again.
Another question.
Hi, my name is Peter Gisela. Dr. Duffy asked Secretary Tom Ridge a question of mine back in 2003, and I just would like to reemphasize that the continuity of government commission is considering the consequences of a small nuclear attack or a lesser WMD on the executive branch and Congress. How do we prepare the nation for the low probability but catastrophic event if it were to take place like 9/11? Now, I've been interested for 30 years in a national service program that would have challenged youth to consider community service or military service.
Let's answer the first question first, if you will, Peter. Because they're different topics. So, Joe, do you want to address this question of a potential small nuclear attack on the leadership of the U.S.? How likely? What are we doing to prevent that?
I'd be very interested in what Tom Ridge had to say about that.
I have the answer right here. A
number of years ago. You know,
post 9/11.
I think the probability of a decapitating attack on the United States is quite small at this point, but it's still not something you can ignore. The U.S. does spend funds on emergency preparedness for catastrophic events like this. It's a very, very small portion of the amount of money that we spend in the nuclear weapons budget. We spend about $54 billion a year on nuclear weapons and related programs. About 1% of that goes to this kind of program. That's the short answer. A somewhat related answer to this is that the United States has, of course, a number of contingency plans for such an attack, for example, during the State of the Union address. None of these, however, are the kinds of plans you'd ever want to see implemented. None of them would ameliorate the consequences of such an attack. It would be devastating. And so the real defense of this is not how you respond to this, it's how do you prevent that such an attack from happening in the first place.
I think we'll go on and let someone else ask a question if there are any other questions. I was wondering, when you speak of this new national security strategy and focus, what do the politics of that look like in the U.S.? You're in Washington, you talk to people on the Hill all the time. We've got presidential candidates, the presidential race heating up. What do you think, what does the debate on national security issues look like overall, and what's it going to look like going into the presidential campaign?
Yeah. Well, traditionally, Republicans attack Democrats as being weak on national defense. just as Democrats attack Republicans as wanting to gut Social Security. These are the pretty standard lines of attack, and there's no reason to believe they won't be deployed in this election. You already see it in the Republican primaries. The trouble that the Republicans are having is that they're not getting much traction with this line of attack. It turns out that even though President Obama's popularity ratings are quite low at this point, dipping below 50%, hovering around 40%, on national security issues, he polls quite well. The American public strongly approve of the way the president is handling, for example, the strategies against terrorism and how he's handling national security overall. And the reason for that is fairly obvious. The strategy has been succeeding. I mean, President Obama is the president that got Osama bin Laden, that is steadily knocking off leadership of the Al-Qaeda network, the people who actually attacked us on 9/11. He's doing also what the American people want in withdrawing troops from Iraq and from Afghanistan. In other words, even though he's waging less war than previous presidents, he's more popular on national security issues. I still think that the Republicans will continue to try to attack the president on this. Most likely that line of attack will be about Iran. You'll probably see a lot of talk in the primaries about the Iranian threat and the need for strong action against Iran. I expect that talk to fade in the general election, however. I don't think any Republican running for Congress is going to want to campaign on a strategy of war. I think that's a losing issue for them. So unlike most elections where you generally see national security issues skew to the right during an election campaign, we may see one where because of the American people and what they want, you may see a national security issue stay sort of neutral or even skew a little bit more towards the libertarian side of the spectrum. That is, let's take care of business at home and pay less money and commit fewer resources to activities abroad.
For those who are joining us via our broadcast, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California's radio program, and our guest is Joe Cirincione, president of Ploughshares Fund, a global security foundation. We're discussing vital security challenges facing the U.S. and the best strategies to confront them. Yes, sir, your question.
Yes, I would like you to discuss the embassy in Baghdad, reported to be the largest and most expensive on the scale of Vatican City, the perception and future role of it, please.
A white Iraqi elephant. This is really, you know, a classic government boondoggle. It was designed, the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad was designed and constructed at a point where the architects of the Iraqi war thought Iraq was going to be our new base in the Middle East, that this was going to be the center of our operations, that the military presence in Iraq would enable us to conduct similar or perhaps more limited operations in neighboring countries. That you may remember some of the talk of those heady days in 2003 and early 2004. In Washington, the saying was, men go to Baghdad, real men go to Tehran. And the idea was we would use U.S. military force or the threat of force to not just overthrow the regime in Baghdad, but overthrow the regime in Damascus, overthrow the regime in Tehran, and as one neoconservative pundit put it, we would set off a democratic tsunami in the Middle East based on U.S. military force. And so the nerve center of this would be the U.S. Embassy in Iraq. Well, all that's come a cropper. I mean, it really is going to be a tough stretch to maintain U.S. forces in Iraq to defend the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad. I mean, 3,000 forces, which is what we're talking about now, as the remaining U.S. forces that some would like to see in in Iraq would barely do the job. Barely do the job. Once you start reducing U.S. forces that low, half of them are kind of required to guard the other half. So I really don't know what value we're going to get out of that U.S. embassy. I don't know what the final tally of that was, but there was a lot of money wasted in the construction, a lot of corruption involved in the building of that embassy. It's frankly, it's a national scandal and somewhat of a humiliation and an example of our, what some have called imperial hubris, the idea that this is what the future of U.S. policy should be. That policy is over. That is not going to happen. The revolutions that may or may not topple the regimes in Damascus and Tehran are not going to be ones that are going to be led by U.S. military forces.
Another question.
Hi. My question is about Obama's approach to foreign policy. During the Democratic primaries of the last election, both Hillary and Obama were asked a number of questions, obviously, but most specifically around Iran. And Obama was sort of at that stage preaching this conversation, idea around engagement.
And yes.
You can't. You have to engage with this. And then it would seem, and I know obviously the track record isn't quite good from Obama, but and at the same time Hillary was saying no, we can't engage. Which is weird because now she's the Secretary of State, and it would seem that Obama's policy is actually sort of tended back towards what Hillary was suggesting in the Democratic primary debates. So I'm just interested what your opinion on that was. Is it the gravity of the situation that had become apparent to Obama after he sat through some security advisements, or was that just good politics? Or what do you think?
Sure. The question is, during the presidential campaign, candidate Obama pledged to engage with Iran and to sit down and negotiate with U.S. adversaries. It was then candidate Clinton who argued against that policy. Now Hillary Clinton, Secretary of State, the president, of course, is the commander-in-chief, and we don't seem to be engaging. So it looks like the candidate Clinton's position prevailed over candidate Obama's position. I would say Obama came into office and tried to implement his policy. You may remember the president's inaugural address on the Mall extended the hand of friendship to the regime in Iran. That hand was rejected for a variety of reasons, including deep mistrust of the United States, domestic politics in Iran, and a sense of Iran, a misplaced sense of Iran's ascendancy by then President Ahmadinejad. Iran declined the offer to engage. They calculated they'd be better off not engaging, that the U.S. was getting weaker in the region and Iran was getting stronger, so why should we now engage with Iran? I think that was the basic Iranian calculation. So Obama didn't have anyone to engage with. And I was pretty close to the administration during this first couple of years and talked with the advisors, and there really was a genuine effort. It didn't work. At this point, I think the Obama administration is like a lover spurned. They just don't want to go back there again. They don't trust the Iranian offers to negotiate now. They think it's a trap. They think there's nothing to be gained. Even though the Iranian view, it was half right. The U.S. is getting weaker in the region. We are losing influence in the region. The trouble is for Iran is that Iran is too. Iran, we're getting weaker together, or getting weaker simultaneously in the region, which is part of why Iran, I think, is more inclined to engage, and why the U.S. should look more carefully at that, the kind of offers you're seeing coming out of Iran. I'm just going to say politics factor into this too. This is one of the problems of trying to do this kind of diplomacy during a bitter partisan election season, which seems to go for 4 years now, which is when you try to do that, you're going to be attacked by your political rivals as being weak. So it becomes, there's a political cost to Obama trying to implement that engagement strategy now. He didn't have that kind of cost back at the beginning of his term. This complication, this, I think, combination of factors is why the diplomatic strategy with Iran is so complicated.
Yes, sir.
As president of the Ploughshares Fund, can you say something about the priorities of the Ploughshares Fund in the coming year?
Well, thank you very much. I'd be happy to do that. Ploughshares Fund has been around for 30 years now. We were founded in San Francisco by Sally Lilienthal, a group of San Franciscans who were concerned that the policies of the United States and the then Soviet Union were going to lead to the destruction of the Earth. We are still worried that the 20,000 nuclear weapons that we have on this planet can lead to the destruction of human life on Earth. Our number one priority is to reduce and eliminate those nuclear weapons. That's a long haul struggle. That these kinds of big issues you don't solve with one bill or one speech or one diplomatic gesture. So we have a multi-tiered strategy to do this. It's summed up in our motto that we find the best people with the smartest ideas and we give them the resources they need to accomplish their goals. We still do that. We fund over 150 groups and individuals who are working on these issues. But we now organize them in efforts, in sort of joint campaigns. And right now we have three priorities. One is cut the nuclear weapons budget. Just as the political season has started to close the window of opportunity for getting significant policy change, the budget crisis has opened up a new lever on this. The defense budget is going to shrink. Military leaders have to choose what weapons do they want, what programs best serve national security interest. Nuclear weapons stand out as the weapons we need the least, the ones that are least important to protecting American interests around the world, yet they consume a very large share of the budget. We spend about $54 billion a year on nuclear weapons. We're planning to develop new nuclear programs over the next 10 years. If the current plans continue, we will spend $700 billion on nuclear weapons and related programs over the next 10 years. That's just as much as we wasted on the war in Iraq over the previous 10 years. This is a price the American people cannot afford. I think military leaders are increasingly seeing this as programs that we no longer need. And we're seeing this on Republicans and Democrats. We see one of the most conservative senators in the US Congress, Senator Tom Coburn, introduce his deficit reduction plan called Back in Black, which calls for cutting US nuclear forces by some $80 billion over the next 10 years, reducing the levels even below the level set by the New START treaty. We see Senator Ed Markey, one of the most progressive or liberal members of the US Congress, offering a plan that would cut over $200 billion out of the nuclear weapons budget in the next 10 years. I like this bidding war. Now we're on the right track. Now do we cut $80 billion or $200 billion? Let's have that discussion. I think that's where this is going, and I think Ploughshares Fund wants to be the leaders of this kind of sensible resizing of the U.S. nuclear force. We also spend a lot of our time on Iran. Iran is a major danger for us, both because of the danger of Iran's nuclear weapons program and what would happen if Iran got a nuclear weapons program that would set back global disarmament and global nonproliferation efforts across the globe. We also continue to have a great focus on U.S. and Russian nuclear policy. You know, Willie Sutton was asked, the famous bank robber in the 1930s, you know, why do you rob banks, Willie? And he said, that's where the money is. Why do we work on U.S. and Russian nuclear policy? Because that's where the weapons are. There are about 20,000 nuclear weapons in the world. The U.S. and Russia have 95% of them. So if you want to talk about reducing nuclear threats, you got to reduce U.S. and Russian nuclear forces. That's got to be your lead element. We also work, as you might have guessed from the talk so far, on Pakistan. This is a very, very difficult issue, and we are developing our efforts on Pakistan, largely around conflict resolution. You know, you can't just talk about arms control treaty or budgets. If you want to get rid of nuclear weapons, you have to go after the underlying conflicts that give rise to the proliferation imperative, that give rise to the illusion that nuclear weapons can somehow enhance a country's security. So we're working heavily on that. Those are our top four priorities. Thank you for your question.
Let me just divert for a second on one of your points about cutting the defense budget and the budget situation now. Leon Panetta, our own good friend from this area, who's been on this podium many times, says the defense budget cannot be cut more. So how do you see that playing out with the defense secretary, who is a budgeteer and very well connected on Capitol Hill, drawing a line in the sand about no more cuts?
I greatly respect Leon Panetta, and I've known him, and I've known a number of his people who have worked for him over the years. I think Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta had a different view when he was the director of the Office of Management and Budget, Leon Panetta.
Yes.
You know, where you stand often depends on where you sit. Unfortunately, there's a tendency in our government for senior officials who represent departments to represent the interests of those departments and to want to be seen as the defender of those departments. Leon Panetta was a fierce defender of the CIA when he was the director of the CIA. He is a fierce defender of the budgets of the Department of Defense. Now, I just think he's wrong. I think he's flat out wrong. There's a legitimate debate that's now taking place in Washington. Just in early October, a group called the Center for New American Security issued a report warning that we couldn't cut more than $550 billion from the defense budget. Okay, we've cut about $350 billion so far. This is from planned expenditures over the next 10 years. It's not actually a cut yet. It's a cut in planned expenditures. This is the way we talk in Washington. A cut in your plans is a cut. So, they're saying we can't cut more. Leon Panetta's saying that's it. You can't cut more than 350. We have this relatively centrist group saying, no, you can't cut more than 550. You have people like the Center for American Progress, where I used to work. Lawrence Korb has done a study saying a trillion. You can pretty much cut a trillion. Gordon Adams at the Stimson Center says a trillion. I'm more in that camp. We're going to spend, under current projections, something like $7 trillion on military spending over the next decade. You can trim quite a bit from that without getting down to core national security interests. So I just disagree with Secretary Panetta. I got to say I'm a little biased. I spent, as you noted, almost 10 years in the U.S. Congress investigating waste, fraud, and abuse in government programs, investigating the Star Wars missile defense program. I was part of the committee that found the $700 hammer and the $900 toilet seat. I'm telling you, there was a
coffee pot, too.
There was a coffee pot. There was a $1,200 coffee pot on the troop transport plane. There is a lot. There's a lot of fat that we can trim from the defense budget before we get anywhere near muscle.
Next question.
As someone who I've worried about Pakistan, but I obviously haven't followed it as closely as you have. Seeing the general developments in Pakistan also colliding with the world economy and hence food prices for Pakistanis and the flood that Pakistan had last year and the reconstruction aid for that flood being so unpopular in the U.S. Congress.
Yeah.
And how I'd like you to riff on how those factors are going to fit together.
Here's something to think about. Muslim views of the United States are harshly negative around the world. Harshly negative. We are actually hated in Pakistan. You poll the Pakistan people, and they think the United States is their number one enemy. An exception to this view is in Indonesia, where the United States has a huge favorability rating. One of the reasons for that is the earthquake assistance that was rushed to the Indonesian people after their devastating earthquake. It showed the Indonesian people that American people cared, that we were, et cetera. I am a big fan of this kind of humanitarian assistance and statecraft. This is one of the things I mean by multidimensional statecraft. You know, people in the world, I think, want to like the United States. They want to be like us. They watch our TV. They listen to our music. They want the kinds of freedoms we have. They want to be on our side. We have to let them be on our side. And so I'm strongly in favor of that kind of assistance to Pakistan and balancing any kind of military assistance we give to any government with an equal or at least an equal share of humanitarian assistance, of educational assistance, of that kind of assistance. I think that can work. And I think that can work with our adversaries. I think we should be giving food aid to North Korea. With all the problems that you get, it's a very difficult situation and a lot of corruption, a lot of siphoning of food aid when you give it to countries, particularly North Korea, but still, I think this kind of thing serves U.S. national security interests.
Yes, sir. Next question.
The Ploughshares Fund has its fingers in many of the nation's national security and peace think tanks. And so with that acquaintance with the intelligentsia, you can make policies. What can the working person of America or China or Pakistan do to advance the cause of nuclear abolition?
Yeah. Thank you very much for the question. I firmly believe that you need to have a multi-layered strategy to make social change. That it's not enough to fund think tanks to come up with reports. In fact, if that's all you do, you can pretty much count on losing the battle. But you need that kind of expert analysis. You have to couple that with what I would call communication strategies. How do you communicate these messages? How do you get them out in the journalistic community, in the popular media? You also need a political strategy. How do you get the political leaders to listen to the expert reports that are being communicated in your communications channel? And that, in part, is where you get to what you might call grassroots strategies, where people doing simple things, like, for example, calling their member of Congress and asking them to support cuts in the nuclear defense budget as part of any deficit reduction package, can really make a difference. I worked in Congress. I know members pay attention to this. Okay, not one phone call, not two phone calls. You got to get up to dozens and to phone calls to make a dent. And when you get to hundreds, they're really listening. When you get thousands, they'll start to vote your way. You got to do that. You can also, citizens can take direct action. Right now, we have two living examples of the impact of citizens' direct action. We have the Tea Party movement, which is direct action, people going out and demanding change. And we now have this Occupy Wall Street movement. We don't know where this is going to go, but it's a very interesting movement. No think tank called for this. No foundation is funding this. No politician is leading it. It's the kind of direct action that has historically been a part of the American fabric. That is part of the kind of people we are, where we don't just leave it up to our policymakers to make the right decisions. We take direct action ourselves and demand that our policymakers give us the policies and the kind of government we deserve.
Lee.
Last year, my wife and I spent some time overseas, and we were able to watch Al Jazeera.
Yeah.
We were very impressed with the quality of Al Jazeera and its newscasting. And yet, you cannot get it on any TV channel in this country. What can we do to make that happen? And wouldn't this improve our relationship with the Arab world?
Yeah. I don't know about what, I don't know if having DirecTV include Al Jazeera in their package would improve our relations with the Arab world, but I wish they would. And you can get some of it from some channels like Linked TV.
Linked TV, based here in San Francisco.
Linked TV started broadcasting Al Jazeera's newscast during the Arab Spring because of exactly what you said. They were just giving better coverage. It wasn't an ideological or political choice. It's that these guys were really good. You got news that you couldn't get from CNN or MSNBC or ABC or even NPR. You just couldn't get it. And I think the American people need to have multiple sources of information in order to make sure that we're getting the news we need to make the right decisions. So I do watch the Al Jazeera newscast when I can get them. I go online and watch them. I appear on Al Jazeera. I think it's important for there to be American spokespeople on Al Jazeera communicating with their audience. I also go on Comedy Central. I am a non-discriminatory interviewee. I go where the people are watching. The people that I want to communicate with watch Comedy Central and CNN and Fox and MSNBC and Al Jazeera. We have to be engaged with all these channels. Just a quick answer to your question. Obviously, if people really feel strongly about this, they should be calling up their cable and satellite providers and demanding that they include these kinds of networks in the package they offer and lowering their prices.
Everyone will vote for that. Let me ask you a question. A lot of the discussion we have is about what the U.S. can do as a country, what our military can do, what our national policy can do, what countries can do to affect this problem of nuclear proliferation and terrorism and security threats and so on. But a lot of what goes on doesn't have to do with countries or national diplomacy. And I actually saw an interesting and strange story on the Ploughshares website, of all places, about funds going from internet gaming to fund illicit activities in North Korea, including possibly the North Korean nuclear program. Do you know about that story? And can you explain what's going on there? And what do you do about those types of sub rosa threats? And I know there's some Ploughshares staff here, so if you're aware of that.
So you mean I should actually read the Ploughshares website? I did read that story. I did see that story. I didn't know anything about it until I saw it there. You know, Tom Friedman recently wrote about how we've gone from a connected world to a hyper-connected world. And what he means is there's multiple communications channels now available to us. As you mentioned, I'm an obsessive Twitterer. I have a Facebook page. We have a web page. We're looking for ways to connect and get our message out. And it turns out lots of people are doing that. And one of the sort of more bizarre things opened up is that it appears that North Korean government operatives, employees, are using gaming networks as a source of revenue, as a way of making money that they can't make legally, that they can't sell a North Korean computer game in the United States, but they can go on the web and by hiding who they are, develop web-based games that people will pay money to play, and that money gets siphoned back to North Korea. That's an example of the kind of complexities that are introduced in our modern internet-connected world. Is it a big source of revenue for them? No, not much. And the fact that it's found out at all, you know, helps you understand how limited this kind of thing could be. The sort of connected and much more serious problem is that there is also a growing threat and concern about cyber warfare and penetration of U.S. and national intelligence networks, computer systems, by cyber warriors, and the U.S. use of such technologies offensively. The most recent example is the Stuxnet virus in against Iran. So this is a virus, as reported by the New York Times, that apparently the U.S. developed and then perfected with Israeli assistance, and got into the Iranian computer networks that operated their centrifuges, and by a variety of secret commands wrecked the operation of many of these centrifuges, knocking out about 1,000 centrifuges out of the 8,000 centrifuges that Iran had operating.
Which are used to enrich uranium, which are used as an explosive and a nuclear device, potentially.
Right. Thank you. So the whole concern that we have with Iran is their nuclear fuel program, which is enriching uranium to low levels for fuel, but could be used to enrich it to high levels for a nuclear weapon. Same machines, same factories, just a question of how much they enrich the uranium. So this cyber program knocks out 1,000 of them. Pretty good. Pretty good. The problem is that Iran could use techniques like this back at us. And now we're starting to get into uncharted territory. We got is there going to be blowback? Will Iran respond in kind with attacks on U.S. computer systems? Or what if we try to do this again? What if the U.S. develops a better Stuxnet, Stuxnet 2 or 3, that knocks out 5,000 centrifuges? Is that an act of war? How different is that from a bombing attack on those centrifuges? What is the response of a nation that's subject to such an attack? This is completely new territory. It's been the thing, you know, it's been the subject of sci-fi movies, from the Matrix to others, you know, and now it's happening. And now we're seeing it unfold before us, and there really isn't any clear guidelines on this. There really isn't any clear rules of the road on this.
Yes, sir.
I wonder why you talk about defense spending in terms of the DOD budget.
Mm-hmm.
The DOD budget represents only about 55% of defense spending. It doesn't include 19 intelligence agencies, which, if you include black programs, are estimated to cost $150 billion a year. It doesn't include special appropriations for wars, which are running close to $200 billion a year. It doesn't, you mentioned the $54 billion in for nuclear weapons spending, but that's hidden in the Energy Department yep. budget. It's not in the DOD budget, so that's additive. It doesn't include spending in the Veterans Administration programs, which are derivative of military adventurism. Chalmers Johnson added the total up shortly before he died last year, and the amount came to $1.3 trillion. Which is a much larger sum than the $700 billion that gets bandied about in public discourse. I think it would be much more useful if we had the full range of defense spending be front and center. And I wonder what you think of that compared to just using DOD figures.
I believe in transparency in government. I believe that the American public need to know what kind of budgets we actually have, how we're spending the money, what the plans are for the future budgets, and what the decision-making process is for those budgets. So I really do believe in what many politicians talk about when they're campaigning, but don't actually implement when they're in office: full transparency in government. The figures you cite, I believe, are accurate. Winslow Wheeler, another budget analyst, came out with a similar estimate of something like $1.1 trillion annually for all military, intelligence, and related expenditures, which includes the interest that we pay in the U.S. debt in order to finance these programs. Remember, we keep borrowing to pay for these programs. We don't actually have this money. We have to go borrow a heavy portion of it to pay for these programs, and therefore we have to pay interest on the debt every year. So, roughly $1 trillion a year figure is the accurate figure for what you might call military and military-related programs in the United States. I think it would be helpful if the government would annually categorize the budget expenditures in the real categories. I particularly would like President Obama to disclose a full nuclear weapons budget. We don't actually know how much money we spend on nuclear weapons because it's not all grouped together. It's spread out over various agencies and various programs, and thus the American people don't understand how much these Cold War weapons are still costing us.
We are getting close to the end of our time, so unfortunately this will have to be the last question.
What do you think China and Russia think about Pakistan, the Pakistan situation? What do you think they're doing about it?
China is an ally of Pakistan. China greatly aided Pakistan in the development of its nuclear program. We believe that China gave Pakistan the bomb design that it used. China is much less interested in promoting Pakistan's nuclear program now. They don't give them active assistance in this regard, but they do treat Pakistan as an ally, and in fact, there's active discussion underway between China and Pakistan about aid to Pakistan's civilian nuclear program, much the same way the U.S. has aided India's civilian nuclear program. I know that Russia is concerned about Pakistan, not in the same way that we've discussed it today, but in terms of instability on its border regions. Russia does have a concern about the Islamic minorities in Russia and in the countries that border Russia, and they are concerned that a destabilized Pakistan can inflame radical Muslim currents that could in turn destabilize border regions of Russia. They don't see the nuclear dimensions of the threat. Both India and Pakistan don't see the threat of nuclear terrorism the way American experts see it. They downplay it, and the U.S. and the U.S. expert, U.S. officials and U.S. independent experts are in constant discussion with Russian and Chinese counterparts on exactly these topics.
The time has come to draw the formal portion of the program to a close. Our thanks to Joe Cirincione, president of Ploughshares Fund, a global security foundation. Our thanks to all of you for terrific questions this evening. Our thanks to our audiences on the radio, television, and internet. I'm Gloria Duffy, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California is adjourned.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. You run a very tight ship. It's a pleasure.